tweeted the other day. Let me get the.
I screenshotted photos of a few people leaving most outlandish and ignorant comments on my post, and naturally they look like this.
Oh no.
It's white men with rectangle lens glasses.
You brought the tweet to real life. Oh shit.
They seem to be a threat to society. What did you mean by that? We're here in Seattle with Gifted Gab. She was named 2015, right? The top 7 female rappers by Time Magazine, XXL. She's Seattle-based, incredible, phenomenal rap artist, and I'm so happy she's with me. Please welcome Gifted Gab, everybody.
Thanks. Thanks, guys.
Thanks for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, before we get into the music too much, your mother was in the church choir, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you were growing up.
Yeah.
And she would sing and kind of practice around the house. You kind of grew up around that, around a musical influence.
Yeah.
Did your mother enjoy singing?
She did. She did. And I don't know if anybody was born and raised in the church, but when you are a child and you're brought up in the church, you don't really have many choices as far as like what you want to do. So like,
right.
I had to sing, you know what I'm saying? I played the piano for like my whole childhood. So sometimes I'd have to stand in for the piano player. Like even, you know, maybe the drummer might not be there. Like everybody knows in like, in like the most basic of gospel music, the drum pattern is the exact same thing, whether it's fast or slow, it's the same drum pattern.
Right.
Some Sundays I just got on the drum set and, you know, kept things going. So, I mean, that definitely helped, like, you know, in the field or like just on the spot type of stuff like that. And like I said, you had to, my mom sang in the choir, my cousins, my grandma. So I had to sing in the choir as well.
So you started playing piano at a young age. You were 6, right?
Yeah, like 6 or 7. And I played till, I want to say I was about like 12 going into 13. And that was when I was like super teenager. Like, man, I'm so fucking sick of having to practice piano like before I go to school, when I come home. Like, that shit was trash. I wanted to play basketball. So I kind of gave up my dream as like the next Alicia Keys.
Right.
To play basketball, which was lit for a couple years. But yeah, that's probably one of the only like regrets in life I have, is like stopping playing piano, because I was really good.
That's odd. You're not the tallest person.
No.
Basketball.
No, I'm not. But you know what? I'm a huge Iverson fan. So if Iverson is a generous 6'1", it could be as good as he is. I knew I could do it. So.
Right. If Muggsy Bowes can do it.
Exactly.
I'm going to learn to duck. Do you remember the first song you learned how to play on the piano?
Honestly, I think it was like a rap song, just like a, seriously, I think it was DMX's Stop Drop, because literally it's just, and I got away with that for a little bit until, you know, the grown folks figured out what I was doing, because I would even, like, in church, like, you know, like, as the pastor is talking, then you do, like, you know, like a light little, you know, little riff or something, I'd just be like,
DMX in the church, yeah.
You know, some of the old people are like, wow, that was a really good tune. And then my mom would be like, I'm going to beat your ass after church. You know, you had to push the limit.
Yeah, most people start with like, you know, Mary Had a Little Lamb or something.
Nah,
row, row, row your boat.
Nah, I went straight to the hardcore shit.
I got kicked out of church at a young age.
You got kicked out of church?
Yes, by my grandmother. I'm not a religious person. We would go on holidays. You know, we were that kind of religious.
Yeah, yeah.
It's Easter. We better go to church,
yeah.
You know? And so we're sitting in church with my grandma, and it's my buddy and I, and my preacher looked like Bob Barker from The Price is Right.
Nice.
And I leaned into my buddy, and I didn't know it was about to get quiet, and I leaned into my buddy, and I go, tell him what he's won, God. And it was just at the moment where he was like,
like moment of silence, everyone.
For prayer. And everybody heard it. And my grandma, I remember grabbed the ear. You know, that's where grandmas go first. They go for the ear.
Yeah.
And yeah, I got escorted out. And that was one of the last times I was at church.
Yeah, I used to get in a lot of petty trouble at church.
Right.
A lot of, just for stuff like that, joking around, or when you go to church, when it's like a family church and all your cousins are there, like, it's like almost an every Sunday thing to see who we can get in trouble first, you know what I'm saying? So like, you'll be sneaking talking, and then, you know, your aunt will look over and be like, you know, so like shit, like we just tried to get each other in trouble for no reason.
Yeah. So you grew up playing the piano, and your mother's in the choir, and you're singing in the choir.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like this path would lead you down R&B.
Yeah.
So what made you switch over to rap instead of the R&B path that you were kind of on at a young age?
Well, I mean, I've always had a love for R&B. It's one of my favorite genres. Honestly, funk, there was like a lot of funk and soul music being played in the house. Like, my mom was a big Ohio Player fan, so we had all those albums which she'd try to hide from me because they were pretty raunchy. But I just love looking at those albums. So, like, you know, funk and soul and R&B are like my favorite genre. But I mean, I was, you know, I grew up on hip-hop, so... Like, even now, people that know me know, they're like, oh, Gab's been singing. But, like, you know, the masses don't really know. So, like, this, even Gab the Most High, the project I dropped, what was it, 2 years ago, I kind of flexed more of my you know,
right,
R&B
yeah.
and, like, melodies and stuff like that. And even for, like, this album is actually going to be half rap, half R&B. So,
okay.
You know, to let people know I can do both.
So I was hoping that you could show me how to properly roll a joint.
Yeah. I can do that, yeah.
I know the weed is not legal everywhere, so I brought oregano. Yes, for our viewers at home.
I have real weed.
I have real weed, too.
Okay. So first things first,
yes,
shouts out to Swisher Sweets with the foil packet. You'll never have a stale Swisher ever again. If anybody rolls blunts, you know that a stale Swisher can ruin your day. So you know you have it, you feel me? This is one of those processes that I could see how it would be difficult for some people, but not for me, because I'm a pro. But so with every Swisher, there's always like a slight, there's like a line in it, whether you see it or not. Even if you see it, like, it makes it easier to do, but if not, you know, you'd really just, all you do with your nail is make like just the slightest incision, like just enough for it to break a little bit. Then what you do, if you just apply pressure like this, it doesn't, it's not gonna fuck up. So you see people that have the Swishers and it's like going all like zigzag and shit. Like, if you just make the incision and just apply like pressure and do all the way down, it'll never, you know, it'll never fuck up.
So at around 13, your mother gets sick,
mm-hmm.
and then you end up moving in with your aunt and uncle in Bel Air. No, I'm kidding. With your aunt and uncle in Oklahoma.
not as interesting version as that.
So you moved to Oklahoma with your aunt and uncle, and you're there for like 3 years.
How about three, four?
Okay, what was that like? Was that a little bit of a culture shock there, going from a city like Seattle to a prairie? Like
pretty much. Oklahoma? Yeah, it was called Okmulgee, Oklahoma. So you can, wow. I'll just let y'all figure out what that means. Like, I want to say maybe my first or second night, it might have actually been my first night, I'm like sitting on my bed like, man, this is my life now, like, fuck, this is fucked up. And I like look out the window and this guy is just on a horse, just like that, walking down the street, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? Like, is this for real? Like, yeah, it was definite culture shock. I mean, even down to like the slang, like, I want to say maybe like my first week of school, somebody said something. And I was like, oh, that's hella filthy. And they're like, what? And I was like, nah, like, not, you're dirty. Like, you know, that's tight. Like, that's cool. Like, it was just, like, it was just off some movie shit. Like, I was that girl, like the city girl that just doesn't get anything they're talking about. And like, I don't know what you guys are saying. But yeah, it was, and this was around like the hyphy movement, like right when, you know, Mac Dre and E-40, like all that shit was popping, like I was lit. So I was out there putting them all on game, like, you guys don't know nothing about this West Coast life. Like, yeah, it was interesting. It was one though, like, I didn't really have a choice. You know, my mom was sick, and my dad, you know, he did his thing. Like, my dad was always there, like, they were married up until she died, but like, he was just kind of the husband, like, what do you need me to do? Like,
yeah,
are
right.
you doing anything? All right, cool.
Like, more husband than father.
Just, you know, Gwen's husband, you know, pretty much. Like, he picked up the slack when he had to, but my mom was like...
A stepdad dad. Yeah.
she was the one. So, like, yeah, so I got sent down there. You know, I was down there for, like, the summer, and my mom was like, okay, you can come back after the summer. She didn't get better, so I stayed down for the school year. And I want to say maybe like a couple months later, I came up to Seattle, and then she died that night. And so I had to go back down there and stay down there for like an additional two years. And it was like, it was rough. I mean, it was really rough, just, you know, not being able to see your mom while she was sick. And then the next time I see her, you know, she's like really sick. Like, you know, if anybody's experienced someone with cancer, like,
And not
seeing the progression, it's like really like crazy to see, like, you know, your mom, and then like the next time you see her, she's like 50 pounds, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was really rough. And then have to go back to Oklahoma, like, I don't really want to go back there now, you know what I'm saying? Like, I want to stay here. So having to go back, be away from like my intermediate family, and have to deal with the country life and all that shit, kind of just get back into the swing of things, like, it was rough. But you know, it is what it is. Definitely.
Yeah, I lost my father at a young age. I was mm-hmm. I was 12, and I lost my real father. And but okay. Yeah, we weren't really close. We were. My dad was on everything but the right path. You know, he was. Papa was a Rolling Stone. You know,
for
and
sure.
yeah, and so he passed. He one morning I was 12. My mom was making breakfast, and I came down, and she's like. Go wake your dad up for breakfast. Time for breakfast. So I wanted to wake him up, and it was too late. He had passed on in the middle of the night. And
oh, wow.
It just goes to show you, man, like, breakfast really is the most important meal of the day. He missed it one time, and just...
Yo!
But you don't really...
The one time.
One time,
fatal.
Man.
God damn.
We don't really know what you know what death is at that age, but you can't really wrap your mind around it.
Yeah.
You know, I was a fat little 12-year-old boy, you know. I was like, I didn't know what death really was. My mother's like, your father's dead. I was like, can I have his bacon? You know, like, I didn't know.
So do I have to go to school? Like, take a week
off. It's like a snow day.
Yeah, basically, damn it.
In this journey in Oklahoma, surrounded by religion and this hiding your music, were you able to heal it all while you were there?
In a lot of ways, no. Just because, I mean... I think the president was, because everybody else knew what was going on and I didn't, it was more of a, like, everybody else had kind of, not like gotten over it, but they understood what it was, like, they've had their grieving time, they knew she was going to die, like, she died from pancreatic cancer, and like, not many people survived from that, so like, they all knew what it was. I just thought cancer, you know, my mom was like, we going to beat this, like, it's going to be okay. So I'm like, you know, a kid thinking like, you know, she's going to beat it. So like, you know, once I actually seen her after all that time and she died, it was like, like everybody else had been through that process. I didn't get a chance to go through it. So it was like immediately I had to go back to school. Like, it was kind of like everybody else was like, well, we kind of already knew, but yeah. Not me. So I don't think really many, you know, like my aunts and them down there, like really like, I don't think they really like understood, or they were just too caught up in their shit, you know, to realize that, like,
it is an interesting thing when you have somebody pass away, especially being that close, you feel like the world goes on pause.
Yeah.
You know, I've lost my mother and my stepfather in the last few years, and you feel like everything's on hold,
mm-hmm.
in your mind.
Yeah.
What you don't realize is everybody else, like you said, is going about their day. They're, mm-hmm. you know, people are still going to work. The world is still turning, and
yeah.
It just doesn't feel like that when you're in that position.
You know, and I'm away from, you know, like my brother, my dad, you know, like all my close family, like all the people in Oklahoma are like family that I met over time, or like, you know, first, second cousins, like all that stuff, like not like, you know, my cousins that I've been with,
right.
You know, my whole childhood. So it was a really, really rough
yeah,
time.
You didn't have that support system that you grew up, you know, being comfortable with.
Yeah, my aunts and my aunt being like, you know, super religious, and then, you know, like kind of abusive at times, like it just didn't really help the healing process, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, get it wet just a little bit, you feel me? Then if this were real weed, you would break it down, you know what I'm saying? Can't really show you. This is fucking crazy, man.
have a weed shaker like this in your house?
Yeah, with oregano in it, yes, that I use to season my, put on my food.
I put them in little shakers.
I can't believe you, Michael. I can't believe when you told me, when you asked me to teach you to roll this, I had you said oregano, I probably would have been like, actually, I'm busy that day, you know? something just came up.
This is great.
This is horrible.
So you eventually make it back to Seattle. You're there, you're in Oklahoma for about 3 or 4 years. Mm-hmm. Then you come back to Seattle, and this is where we can start talking about your music. Is this is when you're about 16, right? You start rapping back here in Seattle a little bit, or you...
Man.
What's the beginning? What's the origin story there?
You know, I'm not even going to front you. I've never actually, like made a timeline for myself just because, like, the whole time I was in Oklahoma was just, like, kind of a whirlwind of just, like, emotion and, like... You know, a girl, you know, coming into her teenager life and, like, having to deal with all just the, just life shit and, you know, all that stuff. Like, I really can't put a time on it. Like, even to the point where I came back from Seattle, I wanted to go to, you know, Garfield. Like, I was born and raised in the Central District. My dad still lives in the city. So it made sense to go to Garfield, you know, but I get my transcripts back and there are none because the school I went to before I came back to Seattle was one of those Christian schools and their whole curriculum was Christian based, which is obviously not accredited in any type of schooling system at all. Yeah. So I came back to school, or not school, but Seattle, and they're like, so you just haven't been to school for 4 years? Like, what's up?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you could either start over school, like, all the way as, like, you know, like, 17-year-old, or just get your GED, which is obviously the only decision, because I would probably still, I would have just got out of high school, like, 5 years ago. So, yeah, no, I had to get my GED. I went to YEP, which is an interagency school.
Okay.
It was like right on top of Bartels in like an office building in downtown Seattle. So like it was one of those schools where, you know, people, you know, kids, they either didn't have like any other options. You had to get your GED, or you had the hella bad kids that got kicked out of all the schools.
Right.
And this was like their last resort. So that was fun.
The going from a church school like that and then going, but you're like, you know, do you know algebra? No, but I know the book of Genesis. I'm all caught up.
That shit, like, I'm telling you, like, everything was such the twilight zone. Like, how was this, like, how was this cool? Like even like the books that they had you in were like, we're high school kids, but like these are like kid books, like, like, you know, little worksheets or workbooks.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of like what
the science was like, not really science. It was like, you know,
if Abraham has three sons and God tells him to kill two of them.
Yeah. It wasn't science.
How many sons does Abraham
have? It wasn't science at all. Even before that, before I went to that Christian school, I had my aunt took me out of the like the actual high school because I guess she thought maybe I would get too corrupted there, or you know, she was crazy as shit. So she took me out of the high school and I like literally homeschooled myself for like maybe about a year. Like she went to, they have those Christian bookstores and they have, you know, like they just sell all types of Christian shit and they have like, you know, a homeschool section for if you really just want to fuck your kid up in life, like here's like we have hella volumes. So she got me one of those and I literally like she had the student one and the administrator one. She like just gave them both to me. It was like here. So I'm like, all right, so I'm just going to fill out these answers, obviously. Like, why would you give me the administrator with all the answers, too? Like, it was bullshit.
It like, sounds like the worst Pinterest project ever.
It was terrible. I'm like, man, I look back at it now. Like, you were really a shitty adult. Like, you were really, really failed raising someone. But, but it did give me a lot of, like, life lessons. And, you know, thankfully, I didn't, you know, let all the crazy shit in my teenage life, you know, like, you know, make me, you know what I'm saying, like, I guess be an outcome of the situations I was in. So, coming back to Seattle was just like, man, finally, like, back to
reality,
reality. But, like, even then, like, my dad, even when I was, like, my dad is hilarious. Like, he's such a, like, my mom was, like, the loving, nurturing. My dad was more of, like, the, like the no, like not sugarcoating shit. Like he just says it. Like he always just say like just wild shit. So like even as a kid, he would be like, when you turn 18, you're out of here. And like I remember him and my mom would go back and forth. Like, don't tell her that. Like, why would you tell her that? She's a child. But like literally, maybe like a couple, maybe like a week or two after my 18th birthday, my dad was like, all right, well. Really? Like, I've literally been telling you for 18 years, like, you can't get surprised at this. So I was like, fuck, well, I guess I'm an adult now. So, you know, he gave me some money to get, like, my first apartment. I'm, like, fresh, like, 17, 18, like, with a brand new apartment. Like, it was lit. Like,
that sounds great. I wish more parents would do that. That sounds awesome.
Yeah. Like, but it wasn't, like, his money. It was, like, some money my mom put aside for me. And he was like, this is a great way for you to spend it. Get the shit, get the fuck out. Like, right, here's an apartment. Like as an 18-year-old, so that definitely helped. You know, I've been on my own literally since right. You know, around that time. So
when my father passed when I was 12, and the money came in and all that stuff, my mother gave me the option. At 12, she asked me. She goes, "Now, do you want to put some of this money back for college, or do you want to get a swimming pool?" I swear to God.
Damn.
And I was like, "We're getting the pool."
So that's even a tough option now,
right? Exactly.
Like, damn.
Oh, man, I love that pool, man.
I learned a lot in that pool.
Learned a lot in that, more, I learned more in that pool than I would have in college.
Survival, yeah, yeah, all that.
It was right at that age, too, you know, right? You know.
Yeah. God damn.
So, I've heard you in other interviews talk about... how you keep getting labeled as, you know, she's really good for a female rapper, and they always put the word female in front of you, and you always, you know, you make the comments of, why can't I just be a good rapper instead of a good female? Are you still, tackling hurdles like that, even though you've proven yourself over again? Is it still, like, people are like, yeah, she's good for a female?
Not so much the good for a female anymore, it's just the female rapper thing.
Right,
you know,
right,
like,
right.
I get it, you know what I'm saying? I understand why people say it, and it's why one of those hard things, like, you know, sometimes I'll even say it just as a descriptive thing, but not as something more of like that's their title, you know what right. I'm saying? So like it's just annoying because in no other profession do people put their gender in front of what they do. And if I said like, man, you're a really good male receptionist, like that sounds stupid, like
right.
What does that even mean?
She's a great female lawyer.
Yeah, like, you know, really what a good. Great male doctor, like, yeah, no one yeah. one says that. So it's, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, some people say it, like I said, as descriptive, like she's a female and she's a rapper, but then other people use it as like kind of a way to, like, I guess demean or just kind of like, I guess, lower me from just a regular rapper. Like, she's, you know, she's a female rapper. Like, what does that mean? Or like when people say like female hip hop, what is female hip hop? Like, I will never understand. What does that even mean? What is female hip hop? I can't understand what, like, that's just an imaginary genre.
Female hip hop, you can only play 1 week a month. I don't know if you know that. Yeah.
Apparently.
Yeah.
But I'm like, how is, you know, Lil Kim and Rod Digga and all the, and MC Light and Missy have all these flourishing careers in just female rap, so what, only females have been listening to? I don't understand it.
So is this I'm gonna tag this up with so this fuel of kind of that anger that goes with that, with being categorized as female rapper and female rap, is that what fueled the Dead Wrong track that you did?
Kind of, yeah. Yeah, definitely. I mean, you can tell from the video, like, I slapped the shit out the guy at the end. Like, you know, just some, you know, female power type shit. Like, you know, we are not to be, you know, played with, and we're not, like, less just because we're a female rapper, you know?
Yeah, it is a ruthless track.
Gift to gab is the illest. You know how I get down to the business. They get astounded on how I be clowning. These bitches spitting rounds at these hounds. I don't care how it sounds. Don't drown in my lyrics. Watch me show out. I see you niggas no bout. Going down that whole route. Cause all you pussies sold out. No doubt, no doubt. Fuck around, get Joe Jack. Know that when I go bad, your whole style gets toe tag. No swag. I see you.
I feel like even just with my whole career and how things started, it started like really like, I would say like easy and kind of seamlessly, just because I was you know, I kind of studied the game for such a long time, and, you know, even down to being a kid, like performing, you know, doing recitals, and right. even in Oklahoma, like I used to do pageants and stuff. So like being in front of a crowd was already something I'd experienced at a young age. So like when I started doing shows, it was, you know, maybe like my first show I had the jitters, and after that, like never again, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So like I was able to, like, kind of blessed to be able to put, like, thrown into those situations, you know, to where I kind of did, like, almost artist development, you know, already. So when I started doing the shows with Morgang, and, like, you know, my first time being in real studios was them, like, it kind of propelled me to, like, now, you know what I'm saying, to where I'm, like, not really, like, I'm still learning shit, obviously, but, like, the basics, like, I've already been doing this shit for, like, so long, you know?
Yeah.
So just even, you know, having that guidance and stuff like that made it easy for that first album, because, you know, someone like introduced me to the studio and like all that stuff. Like now I'm getting like the raw, not the raw ends of the deal, but like now dealing with all that shit. Like my first album was like went flawless, like it was perfect, and then like now this album I'm dealing with now has been like a fucking nightmare for like the last like maybe year. Like it's been a complete, like, just the craziest time, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah, what is that process like, your writing process? Do you sit down you know, at a coffee shop and just write? Do you
mm-hmm.
do you freestyle most of it? Do you work on a live show? Like, what is that writing process for you when you're doing these?
I mean, for what, I'm such a creative, like, in every sense at the end of the day, so like everything I do has order to me, like,
right,
it's yeah. order, and it's like, you know, controlled chaos to me, but from the outside looking in, like, maybe not so much, but you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But yeah, I like, shit just kind of happens, like, just haphazard for me, so, like, there's even, you know, a lot of times, like, I'm one of those people, like, when I say, like, okay, after I get home, or when I get home, I'm going to sit down and write. I'm like doing some stupid shit. Like, I'm never like sitting down
yeah,
writing
exactly.
when I say, like, I'm like watching like some stupid show, or like,
right.
you know, like sewing something. Like, what am I doing? I said, I'm like, I have such crazy ADHD. Like, I'll look up and be like, wow, that is not what I said I was going to do. So like writing and shit, like, for me happens, like, I'll just be driving and either like I'll see something, or I'll like think of a bar, or like just two cool rhyming words, and I'm like, oh, pull over, like, let me get this shit out, you know what I'm saying? So stuff like that, even before I had a car, I'm riding the bus all the time. Like, that really sparked a lot of like writing shit for me, because I could just put on my headphones and like not be bothered, but also like still be in the world to get, you know, those inspirations and stuff like that. And I still do that from time to time, just take the bus just so I can, you know, get some shit out. But yeah, I'm one of those people that, I don't know, like something just sparks, or I see something, like I really can't explain it. And even just writing albums, it's weird, like, I make songs for the albums. Like, I'm one of those people that if I'm gonna make an album, I'm gonna make that amount of songs. I don't really make like excess songs, or like one of those people that make like 50 songs and I have to pick 10.
Right, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I kind of make my songs like that, but at the same time, like, I could have been writing this one song, or started writing this one song like 5 years ago, but like I never finished it. And then maybe like I revisited a few years later, maybe just took like two or four bars out of it and remade it. So there's really no timeline for me when like I'm creating an album. So
right.
like even for this album, some songs I writ like, you know, years ago, and I just like kind of updated it or stuff like that. And then, you know, more when I get into the mode of the album, that's when like, you know, like I have that fire that clicks on. And it's like every single day I'm writing a song. And like
yeah.
My head is just in the music. I'm not thinking nothing else. So yeah, just being a creative, like I said, it works for me, but I can understand how for others, like, you know, I have not been like in an actual relationship since I've taken my craft seriously, which is probably best for like
right.
all parties involved, because I am a mess right now, like a good mess and a bad mess. Like, I don't have, like, I am such a creative that it would take someone at either just as crazy as a creative
right.
or someone that's not a creative. Like, you know, like, it's just real black and white, because all I'm doing is creating all the time.
so you have the first album comes out, and then you do Girl Rap,
mm-hmm.
and then I want to talk real quick on what the few days were like after you find out that you get named as Time Magazine and XXL Magazine's mm-hmm. top female rapper. What were the next few days like in your community, like with Morgang and here in Seattle? What were those few days like after that?
A lot of it was like kind of confirmation that like I'm on the right path and I'm doing the right shit, because like these, you know, big outlets are noticing me. Like I haven't reached out to them, and you know, all this stuff is independent, like independent to where like I created the album and then I just put it out. Like I didn't have like any backing, I didn't reach out to any blogs, like I just put it out into the universe, you know. So I think that was just, that was really big confirmation that like I'm doing the right thing, I'm on the right track, like, you know, I got, you know, the eyes on me right now. So that was really dope. But just with my creative process and being who I am, I'm not one of those people that really like dwell on what I'm doing, as far as like when I put the album out, now it's out, now I'm like focused on something else. So like I've had to like, I've been through the ups and downs and the emotions and all the shit for like the past, like, you know, however long, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's new for y'all, you know what I'm saying? So I'm still, you know, doing what I gotta do, but it's like mentally, like, I'm not there anymore, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's done. So even with like I'm really trying to learn how to live in the moment, you know what I'm saying? As far as like appreciating the things and not just looking at it as it like, okay, cool, we got that. So like, let's try to be bigger. Like, let's do something more, you know, as opposed to like just being like, man, this was really good, let's celebrate this win. And then we move on to that. I'm like such a like, all right, what's next? Like, that was really tight. Like, I really like, it's not like I don't appreciate it, but maybe I just don't like show it like how other people would maybe.
Right.
But like, I am excited, but it's like, it's just like another notch on my belt. Like, there's way more things
like,
I want to achieve.
Next? Yeah,
what's next?
Exactly.
So like, you know, like time seen me like, man, let's see if Oprah, like, let's try to get to Oprah now, you know what I'm saying? So like, yeah, so like just with the album, like, it's, you know, it's like my kid. Like, I've already raised this kid. Like, I'm my dad now. Like, I've raised you, you're grown.
Now get out.
Out, next one. Like, damn it. You know, what you want to do is, you know, make it even, you know, as even as you can. Just spread it out like you would like a burrito or something. You don't want too many condiments in the middle, you know what I'm saying? No one likes that. So you spread it out as such. And then it's just a tuck and roll type of situation. So okay. you get it in there and then you just bring it over and then...
I was that with oregano.
Trash. It's just spilling out, as you can see. You don't want that like powdery consistency with your weed, because this is what's going to happen. It's just going to shoot out of both ends, and that's not cool.
Thank you for coming on. I really appreciate it.
You're
going to stick around and do a song, right?
Might as well, yeah.
All right, cool.
Would y'all like to hear a song?
Yeah!
All right. What the fuck is that shit? Tell me, what the fuck is that shit? Look, I got Wookie by the ounce, Kosher by the P. Rollin' both up in the swisher, take a hit and we gon' see. Is you as high as me? Hoppin' the ride with me. We puffin' on ivory, no shuckin' the jive with me. Come fly with me, I'm up in the pilot seat now. Don't try to speak, just let the weed talk. See, y'all been pumpin' shit out like a Reebok. Yo, we been letting cats down like the detox. I need that heat rock, that shit that make me cough. You hear that beat knock? Well, let that beat drop. Hey, 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 hey. Look, say what you need, boss. I got whatever you need. I be OD flossed. Dressed in the finest garments, I'm dripping the sauce. I just know how to finesse, so I don't see lost. Niggas wanna match they weed, but really I don't need y'all's. Yeah, Michael, I don't need your weed. You really could have kept that shit in your pocket, bro. Look, because I be puffing heavy. You be on that weak shit. You will never catch me smoking on no Reggie. What the fuck is that shit? Tell me, what the fuck is that shit? Look. Said, what in the world is in that bag? What you got in that wrap? A little with this, a little with that. Crumble the wax, sprinkle the keef, cover the hash, nigga, we blew back. Real nigga, yeah, we do that. Chill, nigga, let me kill that. Little nigga, where you steal that? I'm trying to cop the whole half with the deals that I blow the whole sack at the quick pack. I told the pussy niggas get back. Cause them niggas that I'm rolling with really don't like to chit chat. Keep the steel and they let it feel at a kickback. Nigga, fuck with me or fuck around and get kidnapped. Ha, but really that's another rap. Look. It might be on the other track, huh? Got the hunger of a gutter rat, think I need a cut of that. I keep it sacked like a quarterback. What you need, I got all of that. I got the fuck like the parliament. I got the best weed, no argument. Got a green thumb for the garden in, nigga, there's an art in it. I roll blunts like an architect. Grab a couple more or we can all collect. Niggas show love and it's all respect. My niggas got bud and they all connects, yeah.
one time for Gifted Gab.
Thanks, guys.
I need a strong cup of coffee cause I haven't slept. If you squeezing in the sketchy, it's tighter than virgins having sex. Rest is for the achieved, yeah. Or when I'm mad depressed, I'm not sad today and there's a few things I ain't mastered yet. They taking staggered steps, I got castles to protect, huh. Why you think I got this dragon's breath? Some might call me hazardous, not too many that can handle this. I'm a hip hop analyst, let me channel my inner animal. I'm a cannibal like Hannibal when I spit it.
Batman or Superman?
Batman.
That's a trick question. The correct answer is Black Panther.